Hello everyone, I am Rohit from Talent Battle and I welcome you all for this informative video series for InfyTQ developed by Talent Battle. This video series will be helpful for you to get all the updates about InfyTQ. We will be posting all InfyTQ related learning videos on our YouTube channel so that it will be easy for you to get all the related material and it will be like one-stop solution. Don't forget to subscribe to our YouTube channel for off-campus updates and make your career path easy with Talent Battle. Also do join our WhatsApp and Telegram groups. I have added the link in the description section. In this video, we will be focusing on the database concepts. If you check out the exam pattern, you will get to know that there will be 10 questions on DBMS, and after doing the analysis of previous year question papers, we have identified some points that they have focused on, such as table properties, data types, key concepts, DCL, DDL and DML commands, join concept, clauses, keyword, operators, normalization, constraints and MongoDB. So we have divided our discussion into three categories, basically database concepts in this video and basic and advanced SQL in the upcoming ones. So let's start. First is, what is data? Data is nothing but the facts and statistics stored or free flowing over a network. Generally, it's raw and unprocessed. For example, when you visit any website, they might store your IP address, that is data, and in return, they might add a cookie in your browser, marking you that you have visited the website, and that is again a data, like your name, your age, all this comes under the category of data. Data becomes information when it is processed, turning it into something meaningful one. Say for example, the cookie data saved on your user's browser, if a website can analyze that generally, a man of age 20 to 25 visit us more. That is what information they have derived from the data collected. Next is, what is a database? A database is a collection of related data organized in a way that data can be easily accessed, managed and updated. Database can be software based or hardware based with one sole purpose, and that is storing the data. During early computer days, data was collected and stored on tapes, which were mostly write only, which means once the data is stored on it, it can never be read again. They were very slow and bulky, and soon the computer scientists realized that they needed a better solution to this problem. Next one is DBMS. What is DBMS? A DBMS is a software that allows creation, definition and manipulation of database, allowing users to store, process and analyze the data easily. DBMS provides us with an interface or a tool to perform various operations like creating database, storing data in it, updating data, creating tables in the database and lot more. DBMS also provides protection and security to the databases. It also maintains data consistency in case of multiple users. Some examples of popular DBMS can be like MySQL, Oracle, SQL Server, IBM DB2, Postgres, SQL and etc. Now when we talk about the characteristics of database management system, the first one is data stored into tables. Now data is never directly stored into the databases. It is stored into tables created inside the database. DBMS also allows to have relationships between tables, which makes the data more meaningful and connected. You can easily understand what type of data is stored by looking at all the tables created in a database. Now next is reduced redundancy. In the modern world, hard drives are very cheap, but earlier, when hard drives were too expensive, unnecessary repetition of data in the database was a big problem. But DBMS follows normalization concept, which divides the data in such a way that repetition is minimum. When we talk about data consistency, mostly on live data that is being continuously updated and added, maintaining the consistency of data can become a challenge. But DBMS is going to handle it all by itself. Supporting multiple user and concurrent access. It allows multiple users to work on it, like update data, insert data or delete data. at the same time and still manages to maintain the data consistency. Query language, DBMS provides users with a simple query language using which data can be easily fetched, inserted, deleted, and updated in a database. When we talk about the security, the DBMS also takes care of the security of data, protecting the data from unauthorized access. In a typical DBMS, we can create user accounts with different access permissions, using which we can easily secure our data by restricting user access. And DBMS also supports the transactions, which allows us to better handle and manage data integrity in real-world applications where multi-threading is extensively used. Now, when you talk about the advantages of DBMS, those are like segregation of application problem, minimal data duplicity or data redundancy, easy retrieval of data using the query language, reduced development time and maintenance need. With cloud data centers, we can now have database management system capable of storing almost infinite amount of data. And the last one is seamless integration into the application programming languages, which makes it very easy to add a database to almost any application or website. If we talk about the disadvantages of DBMS, the first one is its complexity, and except MySQL, which is open source, licensed DBMS are generally costly. They are large in size. Now, discussing the components of DBMS, the database management system can be divided into five major components. They are hardware, software, data, procedures, database access language. Let's take an example of this particular diagram in front of you, and we will discuss all these components. First is hardware. When we say hardware, we mean computer, hard disk, I/O channels for data, and any other physical component involved before any data is successfully stored into the memory. When we talk about the component software, this is the main component, as this is the program which controls everything. The DBMS software is more like a wrapper around the physical database, which provides us an easy to use interface to store, access and update the data. The DBMS software is capable of understanding the database access language and interpret it into actual database commands to execute them on the database. When we talk about the data, it is that resource for which DBMS was designed. The motive behind the creation of DBMS was to store and utilize data. In a typical database, the user saved data is present and metadata is actually stored. Metadata is data about the data. This is information stored by the DBMS to better understand the data stored in it. Say, for example, if I store my name in the database, the DBMS will store when the name was stored in the database, what was the size of the name, any related data to that, or is it independent? All this information is metadata. When we talk about the procedures, they are referring to the general instructions to use a database management system. It includes procedures to set up and install a DBMS, to log in and log out of DBMS software, to manage the databases, to take backups and generating reports. The database access language is a simple language designed to write commands to access, insert, update and delete data which is stored in a database. A user can write commands in the database access language and submit it to the DBMS for execution, which is then translated and executed by the DBMS. User can create new databases, tables, insert data, fetch the stored data, update data and delete the data using the access language. When we talk about the users, database administrator, or we call it as DBA, is the one who manages the complete database management system, and DBA takes care of the security of the database management system, its availability, managing the license keys and managing the user accounts and access. Application programmer or software developer, this user group is involved in developing and designing the parts of DBMS. When we talk about the end user, now, in all the modern applications like say web or mobile, they are going to store your user data. Then the applications are programmed in such a way that they collect the user data and store the data on the DBMS systems which are running on their server. And end users are the one who store, retrieve, update and delete the data. Now, when we discuss the architecture of DBMS, we need to first understand a database management system is not always directly available for users and applications to access and store the data in it. A DBMS can be centralized, like all the data stored at one location, or decentralized, like multiple copies of database at different locations, or it can be hierarchical depending upon its architecture. Now, when we talk about the one-tier DBMS architecture also exists, this is like when database is directly available to the user for using it and to store the data. Generally, such a setup is used for local application development where programmers communicate directly with the database for quick response. The architecture is logically of two types, two-tier DBMS architecture and three-tier DBMS architecture. When we talk about the two-tier DBMS architecture, it includes an application layer between the user and the DBMS, which is responsible to communicate the user's request to the database management system and then sending the response from the DBMS to the user. An application interface, which is known as ODBC, Open Database Connectivity, which will provide an API that allows client-side program to call the DBMS, and most DBMS vendors will provide ODBC drivers for their DBMS. If you talk about the three-tier architecture is the most commonly used architecture for web applications. It is an extension of the two-tier architecture, as in the two-tier architecture, we have an application layer which can be accessed programmatically to perform various operations on the DBMS. The application generally understands the database access language and processes end user's request to the DBMS. But in three-tier architecture, an additional presentation or GUI layer is added, which is highlighted here, which provides a graphical user interface for the end user to interact with the DBMS. For the end user, the GUI layer is the database system, and the end user has no idea about the application layer and the DBMS system. When we talk about the database models, these models define the logical design and the structure of a database and defines how data will be stored, accessed, and updated in a database management system. While the relational model is the most widely used database model, and there are like variations of types, hierarchical model, network model, entity relationship model, and relational model. When I say hierarchical model, this database model organizes data into a tree-like structure with a single root to which all the other data is linked. The hierarchy starts from the root data and expands like a tree, adding child nodes to the parent nodes. In this model, a child node will only have a single parent node. This model efficiently describes many real-world relationships like index of a book, recipes, etc. And in hierarchical model, data is organized into tree-like structure with one to many relationships between two different types of data. For example, one department can have many courses, many professors, and of course, many students. When we talk about network model, it is an extension of the hierarchical model. In this model, data is organized more like a graph and are allowed to have more than one parent node. In this database model, data is more related as more relationships are established in this database model. And as the data is more related, hence accessing the data is also easier and faster. This database model was used to map many-to-many data relationships. This was the most widely used database model before the relational model was introduced. Now the next is entity relationship model. In this database model, relationships are created by dividing the object of interest into entity and its characteristics into attributes. Different entities are related using relationships. ER models are defined to represent the relationships into pictorial form to make it easier for different stakeholders to understand. This model is like a good design of a database which can be turned into tables into relational model. Say for example, we have a design of a school database, then student will be an entity with the attributes like name, age, address, and ID. address is generally a complex one because it can be another entity with attributes like say street name, pin code, city, etc. And there will be a relationship between them. Relationships can also be of different types. When we talk about the relational model, in this the data is organized into two-dimensional tables and the relationship is maintained by storing a common field. This was introduced by Codd in 1970, and since it has been the most widely used database model, we can say the only database model used around the world. The basic structure of data in the relational model is tables, and all the information related to a particular type is stored in rows of that table. Hence, tables are also known as relation in relational model. And when we discuss about the basic concepts of ER model in the DBMS, we have to first understand the database models, entity relationship model, and this model is used for design and representation of relationships between the data. In short, to understand about the ER model, we must understand about entity and entity set, what are the attributes and types of attributes, keys and relationships. In ER model, entity and entity set is like, consider if an example that student is an entity, teacher is also an entity. Similarly, class and subjects are also entities. An entity is generally a real world object which has characteristics and holds the relationship in a database. If a student is an entity, then the complete data set of all the students will be an entity set. If you talk about the attributes, if a student is an entity, then the student's roll number, name, age, gender, etc. will be its attributes. Now, an attribute can be of many types. Here are some different types of attributes that we can define. First one is simple attribute. The attributes with values that are atomic and cannot be broken down further are called as simple attributes. For example, age. Composite attribute is made up of more than one simple attribute. For example, address, that will contain street name, house number, pin code, etc. Derived attributes are the attributes which are not present in the whole database management system, but which are derived using other attributes. Single valued attributes, as the name suggests, they have only single value, and multi-valued can have multiple values. When we talk about the keys, if the attribute roll number can uniquely identify a student entity among all the students, then the attribute roll number is said to be a key. Different types of keys are like super key, candidate key, primary key. And the relationships, when an entity is related to another entity, they are said to have a relationship. For example, a class entity is related to student entity because students study in the classes, hence there is a relationship. Depending upon the number of entities involved, a degree is assigned to the relationship. For example, if two entities are involved, it is said to be a binary relationship. And if three entities are involved, it is said to be a ternary relationship, and so on. Now, when we discuss about these diagrams, which represents the relationship, those are like entity relationship diagram, which is a visual representation of data that describes how data is related to each other. And when we disintegrate the data into entities, attributes, and setting up the relationships between the entities, all this can be represented visually using the ER diagram. A relationship describes relation between entities, or it is represented using diamonds or rhombus. If you see this diagram, teacher and student are the entities which are connected by the relationship. There are three types of relationship that exist between the entities: binary relationship, recursive relationship, and ternary relationship. When we discuss the binary relationship, it means relation between two entities. This is further divided into one-to-one relationship, one-to-many relationship, like this. This type of relation is rarely seen in the real world, like one-to-one relationship, student and course. The above example describes that one student can enroll only for one course, and a course will also have only one student. When we talk about one-to-many relationship, the example shown here represents that one student can opt for many courses, but a course can only have one student. Now, many to many relationship and many to one relationship. In many to one relationship, it reflects the business rule that many entities can have associated with just one entity. For example, like student can enroll for only one course, but a course can have many students. Many to many relationship, the diagram represents that one student can enroll for more than one courses and a course can have more than one student enrolled in it. When we talk about the recursive relationship, when an entity is related with itself, it is known as recursive relationship. The ternary relationship is like a degree of this relationship is 3, that's why it is called as ternary relationship. A ternary relationship involves 3 entities. In such relationships, we always consider 2 entities together and then look upon the third one. For example, in the diagram shown here, we have 3 entities like company, product and sector. To understand the relationship, we have to define the rules among the model and we should relate 2 entities and then derive the third one. A company produces many products or each product is produced by exactly one company. A company operates in only one sector or each sector has many companies operating in it. Considering these relationships, we also identify the complete relationship which involves the 3 entities, but at the same time we are looking at the 2 entities. Now talking about the concept of generalization, it comes under the category of enhanced entity relationship model. Now it becomes more and more difficult to use the traditional ER model for database modeling as the complexity of data has increased. Hence, some improvements or enhancements were made to the existing ER model to make it able to handle the complex applications in better way. The part of ER model, enhanced ER model, along with the improvements, has 3 new concepts added to the existing. First one is generalization, then specialization, and then aggregation. Now see one by one. Generalization is a bottom-up approach in which 2 lower-level entities combine to form higher-level entity. In generalization, the higher-level entity can also combine with other lower-level entities to make further higher-level entity. It is more like a superclass and subclass system, but the difference is of the approach, that is bottom-up. When we talk about the specialization, it is exactly opposite to the generalization. It is a top-down approach in which one higher level entity can be broken down into 2 lower level entities. In specialization, a higher level entity may not have any lower level entity set, and that's possible. When it comes to the aggregation, it is a process when the relation between 2 entities is treated like a single entity. In the diagram, you can check that the relationship between center and course together is acting as an entity, which is a relationship with another entity called as visitor, right? Now when we talk about the basic relational DBMS concepts, RDBMS is used to manage relational database. Relational database is a collection of organized set of tables related to each other and from which data can be accessed easily. Relational database is the most commonly used database these days. Now, what is table in RDBMS? In RDBMS model, a table is a collection of data elements organized in terms of rows and columns. A table is also considered as a convenient representation of relations, but a table can have duplicate row of data, while a true relation cannot have duplicate data. Table is the most simplest form of data storage. If you check the example, here is a table with column name ID, name, age and salary, and certain records are inserted to it. Now what is tuple? A single entry in a table is called a tuple or record, or it is also called as row. A tuple in a table represents a set of related data. For example, in the previous slide we have seen the table which has 4 records, and the example of a single record is shown here, that is ID 1, name Adam, 34 and 13,000 are the other records. When we talk about the attributes, a table consists of several records like rows, and each record can be broken into several smaller parts of data which is known as attributes. The example consists of 4 attributes, that is ID, name, age and salary. When we talk about the attribute domain, when an attribute is defined in a relation, that is in table, It is defined to hold only certain type of values, which is known as attribute domain. If you check the table represented here, the attribute name will hold the name of the employee for every tuple. But if we save employee's address over there, then it will be the violation of RDBMS model, right? The next is relation schema. A relation schema describes the structure of the relation with the name of the relation, that is name of the table, its attributes and their names and type. Now, what is relation key? A relation key is an attribute which can uniquely identify a particular tuple row in a relation table. When we talk about the relational integrity constraints, every relation in a relational database model should abide by some rules, like following some few constraints to be a valid relation, and these constraints are called as relational integrity constraints. The three main integrity constraints are like key constraints, domain constraints, and referential integrity constraints. When we talk about the key constraints, we store the data in tables to later access it whenever required. In every table, one or more than one attributes together are used to fetch the data from the tables. And the key constraint specifies that there should be an attribute or in a relation which can be used to fetch the data from any tuple. These key attributes should never be null or same for two different row of data. When we talk about the domain constraint, it refers to the rules defined for the values that can be stored for a certain attribute. As like we have explained that we cannot store the address of an employee in the column for name. Similarly, a mobile number cannot exceed more than 10 digits. This comes under the category of domain constraints. Then referential integrity constraints will be like a particular data which exists for that respective relationship to be remain present. If a table is referencing to some other data from another table, then that table and that data should be present for referential integrity constraint to be held as true. When we talk about relational algebra, first we need to understand what exactly a relational algebra is. Every database management system must define a query language to allow the users to access the data which is stored in the database. Now, relational algebra is a procedural query language used to query the database tables to access the data in different ways. In relational algebra, input is a relation, that is table from which data has to be accessed. An output is also like a relation where a temporary table holding the data which was asked by the user. The relational algebra works on the whole table at once, so we do not have to use loops over here to iterate all the rows or the data one by one. All we have to just specify the table name from which we need that respective data, and in a single line command, relational algebra will traverse the entire given table to fetch the data. There are some operations which can be performed using this relational algebra, like select operation, project operation, union operation, different set operation, Cartesian products, and as well as rename operation. Now, considering the relation of ER model to relational model, there are some points that we need to focus. Similarly, we can generate the relational database schema using the ER diagram, and the points will be like entities gets converted into table with all the attributes becoming fields in the table. Relationship between entities is also converted into table with primary keys of the related entities, as also stored it in a foreign keys. Primary keys should be properly set, as well as for any relationship of a weak entity, if a primary key of any other entity is included in a table, then foreign key constraint must be defined. Now, moving towards the next concept, that is database keys, a very important one. Keys are very important part of relational database model. They are used to establish and identify the relationship between tables, and also to uniquely identify any record or row of data inside a particular table. A key can be a single attribute or group of attributes where the combination may act as a key. And why we need a particular key? Because in the real world application, the number of tables required for storing that data is very huge. and the different tables are related to each other as well. Now, to fetch any particular record from such data set, you have to apply some conditions. And what if there is a duplicate data present? Every time you try to fetch some data by applying certain condition, you will get the wrong data. Now, in this case, to avoid all these problems, keys are defined very easily to identify any row or data in the table. When I talk about the super key is defined as a set of attributes within a table that can uniquely identify each record within the table. Super key is a super set of candidate key. In the table defined above, you can see that super key would like have student ID, a combination of student ID and name, as well as phone number. The reason is like student ID is unique for every row of data, hence it can be used to identify each row uniquely. Simultaneously, mobile number is also unique, so that can also have the feature of super key. So all of them can be super keys. When we talk about the candidate key, these are defined as the minimal set of fields which can uniquely identify each record in a table. It is an attribute or a set of attributes that can act as a primary key for a table to uniquely identify the each record in that table. There can be more than one candidate key. In our same example, student ID and phone, both are candidate keys for table student. Now, a candidate key can never be null or empty, and its value should be unique. There can be more than one candidate keys for a table, and a candidate key can be a combination of more than one columns, that we call it as attributes. When we talk about the primary key, it is a candidate key mostly that is most appropriate to become the main key for any table, and it is a key that can uniquely identify each record in a particular table. From the same table, we can say student ID is the column which will be acting as a primary key. Composite key that consists of two or more attributes that uniquely identify any record in a table, that is called as composite key. But the attributes which together forms the composite key are not key independently or individually. So here, student ID and subject ID can have the combination to generate the composite key. Now, secondary or alternative key is like the candidate key which are not selected as primary key are known as secondary keys or alternative keys. The non-key attributes are the attributes or fields of a table other than candidate key attribute or fields in a table. And the non-prime attributes are the attributes other than the primary key attributes. Now, moving towards the concept of normalization of database. Database normalization is a technique of organizing the data in the database. It is a systematic approach of decomposing the tables to eliminate the data redundancy, or we call it as repetition. And undesirable characteristics like insertion, update, and deletion anomalies. It is a multi-step process that puts the data into tabular form and removing the duplicated data from the relational tables. Normalization is used mainly for two purposes. First one is eliminating the redundant or useless data and ensuring that data dependencies make sense, that is, data is logically stored. When we discuss the problems without normalization, if a table is not properly normalized and have data redundancy, then it will not only eat up the extra memory space, but also it will make difficult to handle and update the respective database. Now, moving towards the rules of normalization. Normalization rules are divided into the following normal forms: first normal form, second normal form, third normal form, Boycott normal form, which is also called as BCNF, and the fourth normal form. Now, in the first normal form, for a table to be in the first normal form, it should follow the four rules. First one is, it should only have single atomic value or attribute columns. Values stored in a column should be of the same domain. All the columns in a table should have unique names. And the order in which data is stored does not matter. Now, if I go into the details of the rules for first normal form, that is single valued attributes, attribute domain should not be changed, then unique name for attribute or columns, and the order doesn't matter. If you check the example over here, our table already satisfies three rules out of four rules, as all our column names are unique, and we have stored the data in order we want it to be, and we have not intermixed the different types of data in columns. But if you check the last table, that is subject, which consists of more than one records like OS and CN, which is represented. Now how you will be going to solve this problem? It is very easy, because all we have to do is just the break the values into atomic values. So by doing so, a few values are getting repeated, but values for the subject column are now atomic for each record. Now using the first normal form, data redundancy increases, as there will be many columns with same data in multiple rows, but each row has a whole will be unique. When I talk about the second normal form, we have to be for a table to be in second normal form, we have to follow two conditions. First is, it should be in the first normal form and there should be no partial dependency. Now when we talk about the dependency, we have to first consider, in the second normal form, the dependency parameter of partial needs to be considered, that there should not be any partial dependency. So if you take the example, student ID, name, registration number, branch and address is given, and I can ask from branch name of student with student ID 10 and I can get it. Similarly, if I ask for the name of the student with student ID 10 or 11, again I will have it. So all I need is student ID, and every other column depends on it, or it can be fetch. This is what we call dependency, or it is also called as functional dependency, because here we can say a primary key for a table is the column or a group of columns, that is composite key, which can uniquely identify every record in the table. Now when we talk about the partial dependency, we know that what dependency is, and we are better in the state to understand what partial dependency is. For the simple table like student, a single column student ID can uniquely identify all the records. But now, it will not be true all the time. So if we extend the example by adding one column together, that will also act as a primary key, then create the another table for subject, which will have like a subject ID and subject name, and the subject ID will be the primary key. So if we check this, and the another table, that is score, which is mentioned over here. So together student ID plus subject ID will form a candidate key for this respective table, which can be act as a primary key. Now considering this partial dependency parameter, the removal of partial dependency is dependent on the different solutions, like the objective is to remove teacher name and score table from the score table. Now if I focus on the revision of this second normal form, for a table to be in the second normal form, it should be in the first normal form and it should not have any kind of partial dependency. Partial dependency exists when, for a composite primary key, any attribute in the table depends only on the part of primary key and not on the complete primary key. And to remove this partial dependency, we can divide the table, remove the attributes which is causing partial dependency, and move it to the some other table where it actually fits well. In the third normal form is an upgrade to the second normal form, and when a table is in second normal form and it has no transitive dependency, then we can say it is in the third normal form. Now let's take the example, and before that we will discuss that the table should be in the third normal form when it satisfies the rules of like it is in the second normal form and it does not have the transitive dependency. Let's take the example where we have three tables, student, subject and score. In this score table, we need to store some more information, which is like exam name and total marks. And if I map all these three tables, you will understand the dependency part and what exactly a transitive dependency is. Now what is transitive dependency? With the exam name and total marks added to our score table, it saves more data now. So primary key for score table will be a composite key, which means student ID plus subject ID. Now how to remove this transitive dependency? Again, the solution is very simple. Take out the columns exam name and total marks from score table and put them in the exam table where the exam ID is required. Now the new table finally will be our exam ID, which consists of exam name and total marks. This will remove the transitive dependency. The advantages of removing the transitive dependency is like amount of data duplication is reduced, and data integrity is achieved. Moving towards the next normal form, that is BCNF, which is also called as Boycott normal form. So Boycott has this normal form is a higher version of the third normal form, and it deals with the certain type of anomaly that is not handled by the 3NF. So a 3NF table which does not have multiple overlapping candidate keys, it is said to be in Boycott normal form. Now for a table to be in a Boycott normal form, it should satisfy the conditions like first, it should be in the third normal form where my R is in the third normal form, the relation, and for each functional dependency, say X is pointing to Y, where my X should be a super key. Now if I focus on the example, we have a table with student ID, subject and professor, and if you see, one student can enroll for multiple subject, and for example like student ID 101, he has opted for subjects like Java as well as he has opted for subjects like C++. Now for each subject, a professor is also assigned to the student, and there can be multiple professors teaching one subject like we have for Java. Now what the role of primary keys here and how to satisfy the BCNF? Now to make the relational tables which is satisfying the BCNF, we will decompose this table into multiple tables like student table and professor table. Now you can check in the student table we have student ID and professor ID, and in the professor table we have professor ID, professor name and the subject, right? So in this way the relation satisfies the BCNF. Now moving representation of a generic explanation which will help you to understand the BCNF. Considering the relationship that is R of ABCD and which has certain dependencies like A is depending on BCD, BC tends to AD and D tends to B. Now in the above relationship which is already in the third normal form and the keys are A and BC. Hence in the functional dependency A tends to BCD is the super key, and in the second relation BC tends to AD where my BC is also a key. But in D where D tends to B, D is not the key. Hence we can break our relationship into two relationships, that is like R1 and R2. And R1 consists of ADC and R2 will have DB. Now breaking this table into two tables, one with ADC and while the other table will be have the components or the relationships will be of D and B. So I hope you have understood all the concepts related to the basic part of DBMS. Watching all these videos on the YouTube channel will help you to prepare for InfyTQ. So do not forget to subscribe the channel. Thank you.